announcements that I've missed? Any blessings? Again, we're blessed to have you with us and to be able to worship today. And we, at this time, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Please stand and join us for our opening hymn, number 337, Jesus Calls Us Over the Tumult.
Jesus calls us over the tumult of our lives, wild, restless sea, day by day his sweet voice soundeth, saying, follow me. Long ago apostles heard it by the Galilean lake. Turn from home and toil and kindred, leaving all for his dear sake. Jesus best of all.
Please join me in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you in all things. We know that you will give us the peace and strength to walk through what life gives us, and that you will be walking with us. And we thank you for that, because it is so important for us to have that assurance that you are with us at all times. We thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and for the teachings that he gave us, and the love you have shown us through Jesus, and hopefully that we can show your love through the world by our actions. Within the following the teachings of Jesus, we say together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. And at this time, if our young people will come forward for our junior disciples moment. Well, kids, you guys want to join me back here? How are you doing?
Good. How about you?
I don't feel so well, but I'm going to be okay. Thank you for asking. All righty. Hello, Jet. Hello, Jace. Do you need a stool? You're good? Well, today we're talking about, in the sermon, the Lord's table. And that's why we're at the Lord's table today. And it's... Okay. Shake your hands. Do you know what this is? Communion cup, and what's inside the communion cup?
Bread.
And what does the bread represent?
The body of Christ.
The body of Christ. And what is the body of Christ? Yeah, the Romans crucified Jesus, but that's one thing, that Jesus had a physical body that he gave because he loves us. Okay. What else is the body of Christ? Yeah. Christ lives in us, right? So when you look out there, that is also the body of Christ. All right? And why would we call the church people the body of Christ? That's a tough question. This is a seminary question. But I think you're smart enough, especially the Swift boys. Why would we be called the body of Christ. Yeah, and that's exactly right. We are the body of Christ. When they killed Christ on the cross, his ministry did not end, his teachings did not end, but he handed them off to us. Jesus resurrected from the dead, but also his ministry went on. And those people that followed Christ and formed the church to become the body of Christ in the world, then and now and forever. So that's why it's so important for us to come to this table, because we need to remember not only did Christ die for us, but Christ sent us out into the world as his body. Okay? Is that a heavy responsibility or what? That's a heavy responsibility. And a week from Wednesday, you guys are going to be leaders in the Children's Christian Fellowship. Okay? And there's going to be kids from your school, and you're going to witness to them God's love so that one day they too might be the part of the body of Christ. Not that they will just be believers, but they will continue the ministry that God began in Jesus. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
All right. Let's pray. Our loving Lord and God, we're so very thankful for this table, and because this is where we learn about God's love. And when we leave this place, we share God's love. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. In addition to our prayer concerns today and the bulletin insert, please remember our great church secretary, Kim Manier, as she is preparing for surgery. She's going to be out for a little bit. We're very thankful for those who are going to be filling in for her, even Gary. I just received this. Charlie Wall needs your continued prayers. His cancer has spread. Brothers and sisters, let us remember these and all others listed in our bulletin. Now let us share in the prayer hymn as we prepare our hearts for the time of prayer.
Father's throne.
Let us pray. Our Lord God, we ask that by your Holy Spirit, we would experience the joy of your love, the wondrous compassion of your grace. You have called us your children. You call us your friends. You have searched us and known us and called us by name. And we know we are yours. For those who find themselves in the depths, may your love illuminate their darkness. In grief, in violence, sickness, and loneliness, may we hear the sound of your voice, feel the grasp of your hand. You are near, O God. And may we breathe a breath of quiet, a breath of thanksgiving. May your peace enfold us in the wind and smile upon us in the stars. For where can we go from your love? In all corners of the earth, your grace pours out. It's as vital as the rain and as delightful as music. And we give you thanks for your symphony. We give thanks for your care. And now, God, we ask for your care to be given to those who are in our concerns that weigh heavy in our hearts, and we offer to you our prayers for them. Hear us, O God. We give you thanks. In the name of the one who saves us, Jesus Christ, amen.
There is a book out that says you have to know the why. And you often think, and we often ask, why me? Usually those questions come when we are in despair, when we're in trouble. But have you ever thought in your blessings, why me? I've often thought, why was I born in this area? Why was I born in the family I was born into? I had no choice. It happened. You could ask that to any situation. But what do we do with it? You know, why was I born in a family that brought me to church and was raised in the church? Was raised to believe God and to know his love. And I think about those who were not. And that's a blessing. And I think all of us can look and think back about that. I was often told as a child to quit asking the why questions because I was always asking the why questions. That's just part of my nature. As, you know, we all have things that are part of our natures. So as we come to our stewardship time, we've received many blessings from the Lord. Why? I don't know. But let's think about giving back to the Lord what is right, not what is left.
God from the
come to you with thanksgiving. We share the blessings that you have given us with others. We ask that you will guide and direct us in all things, that we may be good stewards of your gifts to us, and that we may use them to better the world and show your love throughout the world, throughout our community, throughout our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I think it'd be good for us to welcome the new member of the choir, Sis Seabolt. And thank you for sharing your gift with us. Our gospel reading today comes from Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 30. And this is Matthew's account of the institution of the Lord's Supper. While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. A majestic cathedral in Northern Europe was known for its magnificent organ. Gary, have you heard this one? Good. Unlike the electric organs of today, they hired someone who would pump that organ by hand so that the air needed for the organ to produce the beautiful sound. This cathedral had a great organist, almost as good as Gary, and Marilyn, scheduled to play a 4 o'clock recital at this great cathedral featuring the works of Mozart and Mendelssohn. This brilliant organist bowed before the crowd and said, "For my first selection, I will play a piece by Mozart." And he sat by the organ and did like Gary and started to pound the keys, but guess what? Nothing happened, no sound. He attempted a second time, but again, no sounds. This time, very aggravated, he said loudly to the guy pumping, "I will play this piece, please." And he returned to the keyboard and still no sound. And when everything was quiet and the organist was so exasperated, a voice came from behind the organ, said, "If you don't say we, I ain't going to pump." The organist smiled and said, "For our first selection, we will play a piece from Mozart." And great music was heard by all. We are the Church of Jesus Christ, and we always play its best music when we realize that it is we and not I. Perhaps this is why our Lord Jesus Christ gave us this table that's at the center of our worship, in the center of our faith, because this table teaches us that we are a community of faith. We gather here like a family assembled to break bread. At his table, we are reminded that we are one, one body. The sequoia trees. Chris, are you? The sequoia trees. They're pretty big, aren't they? Do you see them when you go out west?
No.
Oh, you do not? Well, I'm sorry. The sequoia trees never grow in isolation. Never. Sequoias only survive because they are close to one another. This, despite the very large size to which they grow, they have very, very shallow roots. They survive because the root system of each tree is interwoven and connected to those of the neighbor. That's where their strength comes from. When the fierce winds come, the trees literally depend on one another to stand. There is no individualism among the sequoias. And they teach us that community is where our strength lies. One of the greatest threats to the Christian community in the 21st century, I believe, is this fierce individualism among our people throughout America. It prevents unity. Everyone seems to tend to go their own way, and their way is the only way. They have their own agendas, and they are isolating themselves from one another. But at the Lord's table, we are reminded that we are a community. Our disciples' general church's mission statement is we exist to bring healing to a broken world. And when we go to the Lord's table, that should be our prayer and our mission. We're also reminded of our common hunger. That's what the Lord's table is all about, isn't it? To satisfy our spiritual hunger. Jesus knew that the greatest human hunger, beyond all the other hungers and desires, is the hunger for God. When we deny that hunger, we will seek to satisfy it with false and empty substitutes. We wind up with a deadly self-righteousness, and something beautiful dies within us. Christ knew that there is hunger in the soul, and that his bread is the only thing that can satisfy. Yes, this table reminds us that we are a community, but it also reminds us of our common hunger. But it also reminds us of our common hope. The Son of God has come into our midst. Our sins have been forgiven, and through him all things are possible. As you know, the Lord's Supper had its origins in the Jewish Passover, the remembrance of the night that God sent death upon the firstborn of all the Egyptian households, but passed over the households whose doorposts were covered with the blood of the Lamb. And it was this incident that led the Israelites gaining their freedom from slavery in Egypt. The Passover tradition begins with the youngest child in the family asking the father, "Why is this night different from all other nights?" This is the father's cue to begin telling the Passover story. When our Jewish brothers and sisters eat this meal at Passover, they celebrate their freedom from the bondage of Egypt and the new opportunities for life that God has graciously given to them. In our Passover feast that Christ gave to us, we also think of the freedom that he gives us from the bondage of sin, guilt, shame, and death. Christ makes us a people of hope. Why? Because of what he has given to us and done for us. Lastly, we come to the table because of our common faith. The table reminds us that we all, each and every one of us, belong to him. It reminds us that despite the fact that we gather as different people from different backgrounds, male and female, young and old, rich and poor, ethnic groups, through the shed blood of Christ Jesus, we are all united as one body in common faith. The word sacrament comes from the Latin word sacramentum, which originally referred to the oath of allegiance to the Roman emperor. Whenever we receive the Lord's Supper, we are repeating an oath of allegiance, not to any emperor of this world, but to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Christ Jesus. We are not here tending a dead tradition. We are paying homage to our living Lord. So why do we cherish the Lord's table? Because we are a community of faith. Because we have a common hunger, because we have a common hope, because we share a common faith. Brothers and sisters, let us prepare to gather around the Lord's table, to break bread, and to drink the cup of the Lord. Please stand and let us commit ourselves to our Lord and Savior. And now prepare your hearts to receive the love of God made known to us in Christ Jesus at his table, so that we might be prepared to share Christ's love with the world.
Join me in prayer. O merciful God, when you wanted us to be childlike, we have been childish. When you wanted us to cooperate, we have been competitive. When you have wanted us to lift one another up, we have torn one another down. When you have wanted us to be peacemakers, we stir up conflict. Yet this communion table is to us the sign of your love never gives up. Your patience never gives up. Your forgiveness never gives up. As we break the bread and drink the wine, we who are so often weak find the strength we need to try again, to live as you would want, following Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us remember that on the night in which our Lord was betrayed, he took the loaf. He blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." In the same manner, he took the cup also, the cup of blessing. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for the sins of all. Take and drink." Gracious God, we give you thanks because when we come together at this table, we bear our burdens to you so that the body of Christ does not ail. We bring the ailments of negativity, the ailments of anger, the ailments of judgmentalism, the ailments of sin in all categories, because these things not only bring us down, it brings the body of Christ to a sickness. Here at this table, you heal us, you forgive us, and you say, we are your body to go into the world, to continue the ministry you began, a ministry so important that you gave your life for it. May we seek to have a love for your kingdom and your ministry. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. And as we leave, I have one more prayer concern. Anthony Escobedo is in the hospital. Please remember him in your prayers this week as well. May Christ lead you into God's world this week, and may we live as faithfully as we are able to be the body of Christ. So